We are very privileged and honoured to have as a speaker the author of Three Camels of Smyrna, Antony Wynn. I've known him for a few years, and I'd like to give a brief introduction to his earlier life, shall we say. He read Turkish and Persian at Oxford, and in 1972, Brian Huffner of the Oriental Carpet Manufacturing Company, which was the giant trading in Oriental carpets, took him to Hamadan in Iran, and he worked as a carpet buyer there till 1976, when he started to operate, manage a country racehorse track in northern Iran, Turkmen region. And shortly after that, he moved to the new Tehran racecourse till December 1978, when the Ayatollah had the big revolution and everybody had to leave, and presumably Antony also left quickly. After that, he started selling large amounts of meat, Brazilian beef and New Zealand lamb, to Arab governments. That lasted for 15 years?
12 years, yeah.
12 years. And then he started his own company to sell drill camp supplies to oil companies working around the Caspian Sea, which I think was also quite profitable. And he's kept close links with Iran. He's gone and come back quite a few times in the past 15, 20 years. He's also the author of another book, Persia in the Great Game, Sir Percy Sykes. Explorer, consul, soldier and spy, I believe, and which I haven't read, but I'm sure it's lovely. This book is going to sell if anybody wants after the lecture. And he's also a contributor to the Cornucopia magazine, magazine of Turkish culture. Yeah. And he is the chairman of the Persh
Iran
Society in London as well. So, there we go. Antony Wynn.
Thank you very much. I might just explain. Can you hear at the back?
Yes.
I might just explain how I came to write these books. I'd worked with the Oriental Carpet Company for a number of years, and then Brian Huffner, who had virtually owned it, pleaded with me for years and years to write the company history. And I said, well, nobody wants to read a company history. It's about as thrilling as a train timetable to read. But then I looked at it and I said, well, would you, I realized that these people had started out in Turkey in 1907, and they'd went to Iran, Afghanistan, North India, and the various letters and so on they had in their archives recorded the sort of historical events that had washed over them, wars and revolutions. And so I said, well, would you allow me to write the history of Turkey and Iran and Afghanistan and India as seen through the eyes of the Carpi people? Well, luckily, he agreed to let me do it, and that's what I've done. So I don't want to give history lessons to a Turkish audience. I think the expression is tereciye. But anyway, I thought what at least I could do perhaps is to refresh some memories and tell the story of Turkey and particularly Izmir between the years of 1907 and 1929, which of course was a very turbulent period. And we see it through the eyes of the Oriental carpet manufacturers. You'll have seen, some of you will have seen a lot of these pictures, but it just sets the scene. And of course, as you know very well, since the times of Byzantium, the Europeans in Constantinople and Smyrna had of course lived in this commercial paradise, and they lived like kings. That of course is the sporting club, you will know. And of course, benefiting from the capitulations of the treaties that were signed first with the Byzantines and then with the Ottomans, the Europeans were subject to their own national laws, which were administered by their own consuls, and they paid practically no tax. Probably worth realizing, if you didn't know, that capitulation in English sounds like giving up, surrendering, but in fact it comes from the capitula, the Latin, meaning the little chapters in the treaties that were signed with the Byzantines. And of course, Smyrna in those days, although the principal language was Greek, but there is a picture of the Turkish quarter. Most English writing seems to forget that Turks lived in Smyrna as well. And of course, with its wonderful harbour and the fertile hinterland, Smyrna had become a prosperous centre of export trade in dried fruit and tobacco, licorice and carpets. Now, at the beginning of the 20th century, the principal exporters of carpets from Smyrna were the Spartelli family. They were originally an Armenian family. They were known as Spartalian, but they decided to adopt a little bit of protective camouflage and call themselves Spartalo. But at the time we're talking about, which is 1907, the company had been taken over by the Aliotti family, and Enrico Aliotti had married into the Spartalli family. And this family employed thousands of weavers right over central and eastern Anatolia. And another family was the D'Andria family, also Italian, and they'd been in Turkey, of course, for centuries. And then we come to the two English families, if I can call La Fontaine's English. They became English. And, of course, the bakers. So La Fontaine, we have a La Fontaine here, so I have to be very careful what I say. But, of course, La Fontaine's, take them one by one, La Fontaine's particular expertise was in the design and in the dyeing. And here's the La Fontaine design works. And these are this is the sort of thing they worked on. And a lot of these designs are now in the Izmir archive, in the Izmir University, Ege University archive. There are great libraries of these, but we'll talk about how they work with the designs later. And looking a bit further on, we can see this is the old dye house, and of course at that stage they were very much using natural dyes, and chemical dyes didn't come in until much later. And then a couple of years later it gets a little bit more modern, but you know, not much. But of course you can't make decent carpets without good dyes. So that's the La Fontaine's. Now the other elements of this company as it gradually gets put together. We talk about the bakers. Now the first baker of the GP&J Baker Company had come to Turkey in 1847, and he had come to work with the British Embassy designing the gardens. And the Sultan saw it and admired his work and brought him down to Dolmabahçe. And he did very well in business, he was very clever, and he decided, he sent his sons to England with just a few carpets to see if they would sell. And they did sell. And then by 1887, he got his two sons importing Turkish and Persian carpets into London. And this dates from 1889. That's their advertisement of their setting up in Newgate. So then, and of course there were Turkish exporters as well, and the most famous one of those was a family called Çolakzade. But of course they worked on a much smaller scale than these ones. So by 1907 you've got all these companies, you've got the bakers, the Spartelis, the Aliotis, the D'Andrias, and the local Turkish companies and other companies all competing ferociously to buy carpets, to work with, to employ weavers. And they were killing each other with competition. So they decided that these families would get together and form a cartel. And the one element they needed, apart from, was of course raw material. So they then brought in the Sykes family, who had the wool mill at Bandarma, which produced yarn and cloth. And here are some pictures of their mill, which I got from Brian Giro's family album. But you can see the scale of the thing already. So now you've got the wool, and you've got outlets in London, you've got buyers, you've got weavers. All they had to do is bring it all together and produce this cartel. There's the washing plant. Of course, they have the wool, when it comes in raw wool, it has to be washed before you can work it. And then they get together, and there's more process that you can see. And then, of course, washing the... Again, once the carpets are ready, you have to wash them. And they get together, and this is the cartel, the company. They all get together. So the competitors are now working together. And you can see the dates of the establishment of some of these firms. As companies, they've been there, Andres, since 1836, but they'd first arrived in Smyrna in the 16th century, as far as I remember. And they floated the thing as a public company. And that, this wonderful thing, they still exist, you can still find these. That's a share certificate. And then one other element needed to be brought in, and this was the remarkable character, Charles B. Fritz. And he was American. He was a very, very colourful American adventurer. And he had pitched up in Constantinople in the last years of Abdul Hamid, when, of course, with all the turbulence going on, the lives of certain government officials were often in danger. And one of the viziers was being chased by the revolutionaries and had taken refuge with the Whittles in their house in Moda. Mm-hmm. And the lovely story about Mrs. Whittle fighting off the revolution with her umbrella. Anyway, this man, he comes into the house and he wants to get away to Italy. Now, Fritz is in Constantinople, and he's also about to set sail for Naples. And then one of the officials at the British Embassy realized that Fritz had a visa or a space on his passport. His passport to cover both himself and his wife. And his wife wasn't travelling with him, so, if you like, there was a sort of a vacancy. So he persuaded Fritz was persuaded to allow the vizier to put on a yashmak and cover his face and travel as his wife. And he was rescued and got out to Italy. And some years later, things settled down, the vizier went back to Turkey and he got his job back. And Fritz turned up and went to see him, and the man was very grateful. And as a sign of his gratitude, he arranged for the Sultan to grant him the entire concession for the Anatolian wool clip. In a complete monopoly on Anatolian wool. I mean, this is just a tiny bit, just imagine mountains and mountains of wool all in the hands of Fritz because of this one act. So now we've got a complete cartel from the sheep right through to the carpets and the sales outlets in Europe. So how did it all work? How did carpets happen? Two ways. Oh, hang on. Yes, you see what they've got. So they're set up now. You can see they've got all these branches now. Smyrna, Constantinople, Athens, Paris, Toronto, Sydney, New York with Fritz, and so it goes on. But how did it all happen? The European market, they had to have consistent quality, so they set up these factories around Izmir, where they controlled the production, they controlled the quality of the wool, they controlled the quality of the dye, they could supervise the weavers, make sure they weren't making mistakes and getting the design right. And it's on an industrial scale already, it's mass production. But of course you could only get so many women to work for you in the cities. So they had to expand, and they then went out, of course, to the villages. This worked slightly differently. They had agents dotted all over the country, and the agents were given wool produced by the OCMs, OCMs' own wool, their own dyes, their own designs, and sometimes they even supplied them with the correct loom that would produce a straight carpet with no wiggles in it. And the local inspectors would go out and they'd check the progress to make sure that they were getting it right and not skimping the wool and not cheating too. Because you're given the wool, the temptation of course was that if you were a villager that you would sort of keep half the wool for yourself and produce a slightly smaller carpet. So all this had to be checked all the time. There's a lot of trust in it. You could only give out wool to people you actually trusted. Anyway, it got going, and by the end of 1910 Within 2 years after the foundation, this cartel was employing something like 100,000 weavers, working on 20,000 looms in 27 towns and cities all over Western and Central Turkey. And they, by this time, they were controlling about 90% of the Turkish carpet production. Why did they push eastwards? The reason was quite simple. As they started employing more and more people in the west of Turkey, and as the west of Turkey began to industrialize and develop, wages went up. So you moved east, where wages were cheaper. And they had to go on doing this. They went right up to Sivas and beyond, looking for cheap labor. And then how did the carpets get out? Camels, hence the title of the book, Three Camels to Smyrna. Mm-hmm. And here they are. You know, even postcards were produced to show these camels coming along. And just to give you a picture, I mean, just imagine the quantities of carpets plodding slowly, slowly in, all to Smyrna. They all got packed in Smyrna and then sent off off to Europe and America. And then, of course, there they are arriving at the, or be, after being unloaded at the waterfront. And, of course, after the state railways, the OCM was the biggest employer in Turkey, the second employer in Turkey. The profits they made were absolutely phenomenal, because being a cartel, they controlled everything. And they were a banker's dream, and the bankers were falling over themselves to lend them money, because this was a, you know, the sure way of getting your money back. So, before we do that, we'll just try and show you the catalogue. Just show you the sort of carpet they were producing. Get right back to the beginning somehow. Oops. I'll try and do this. It's just the way it sits. Hang on. Ah, wait a minute. What do I do? Yeah, there we go. Right. I'll just run through this. I found this catalogue in the Izmir archive, in the Kent Arşivi. I think only two or three of these things survived, but you can just see the scale of it. Now let's run through it. Just you can see what they were doing. Right, these are the sort of carpets they were producing. This is all, yes, and the, you know, they're quite, there's very fine production. A lot of this, of course, is the Spartali production. I mean, that's a lovely thing. Mm. See, okay, well, this is obviously a Persian design, but you know, very fine work. So this is the catalogue from the very first year of production. This is what they were offering. Mm. Now we get to something more recognisable, what you might call a Turkey carpet nowadays. That of course is a copy of the Chelsea carpet, the in the V&A. And that's the end of it. So that's the end of the catalogue. I just thought it'd be worth showing you the kind of things that they got up to. Let me just get back to that. To go now to. Right, so back to where we were. So this is unloading in the. Anyhow, of course, you know, it hadn't been an easy start, because January 1908, the cartel was founded, which was what, 103 years ago. In January, immediately, the first thing that happened in January, there was a banking crisis in America, and the stock market lost 50% of its value overnight. And that crisis paralyzed trade over much of the world for 4 months, and had a particularly bad effect on the demand for luxury goods, especially carpets. So for the first half of 1908, there was practically no business at all that they could do. And it was a result of this banking crisis, believe it or not, that the Americans established the Federal Reserve Bank to make sure there should never be another banking crisis. 1908. First year of the OCM. Not just that. Of course, as you know, it was the constitutional revolution in Turkey and the rise of the Young Turks. And of course, the Young Turks of Salonika, still then part of the Ottoman Empire, sent a telegram to the Sultan demanding a new constitution. And the newspapers of the next day amazed the public with these new words, that freedom, you know, hürriyet, milliyet, meclis, all these wonderful words, never been heard of before. And I was in Moscow, actually, the night that Gorbachev announced his perestroika and glasnost. And I tell you, that night, you know, the atmosphere was absolutely electric. And I imagine that 1908 in Istanbul would have been much the same. But the new constitution, of course, quite apart from political reforms, led to a period of social and economic liberalism. And, of course, educated women began appearing in public without veils. But at the same time, of course, the Ottomans lose Bosnia-Herzegovina, they lose Bulgaria, they lose Crete, all in the same year. And in the same year, of course, you get strikes in work among workers in the coal mines, the railways, and the new factories. So you've got national humiliation, industrial upheaval, all happening at once. And of course, many Turks began to think that all this new liberalism might have been a mistake. And there was a call for the abandonment of these new ideas and a return to the old certainties of firm government, Islamic law, and back to the hijab. This, they thought, might have been responsible for all the trouble they were having. And there was a famous riot, going back to carpets, in Uşak. The women of Uşak, the spinners, the spinning women who spun wool by hand, like Luddites, they came up and they smashed the new spinning factories, the spinning mills. And what had happened was that they had built industrial spinning mills because the annual production of carpets in Uşak had increased in 10 years from 75,000 square meters to 250,000 square meters. And that's 42,000 carpets a year in Uşak alone. And of course, the hand spinners couldn't possibly keep up with the demand. And I haven't got a picture of Uşak hand spinners, but these are the sort of people. This is what they were doing. That's Indian. She's Indian, but that's what they were doing before these industrial machines came. And they were carding like that. And of course, the new mills took work away from these poor women. And no wonder they went up and smashed the mills. Now, of course, now the Ottoman Empire was still a cosmopolitan state, and were with Christian Greeks, Armenians, Jews, and Balkans, Arabs from Syria and Mesopotamia, and of course, you know, generally speaking, the minorities they had civic rights and they were protected. And the OCM, as it expanded further and further into Anatolia, employed, I didn't really notice this, but you realize it after a bit, their weavers were almost without exception Greek or Armenian. And when I was giving this lecture to the Izmir University 2 or 3 years ago, at the end, a couple of students came up to me and said, well, why did they only employ Christian weavers? Were these Frankish carpet people, were they against the Muslims? And I said, well, no, not at all, far from it. They would much prefer to employ Turkish weavers. They thought they were probably better. But the big problem was that, as I showed you earlier, they had to have control of the production, which meant that they had to go into the houses in the villages to check the production over the shoulders, look over the weavers. And of course, Muslim families wouldn't allow strange men into their houses to do these inspections. So that was that. And then one of the students said to me, well, you know, simple, why couldn't you send lady inspectors out? So I said, well, you know, 1908, 1910, what sort of family, Christian, Muslim, or anything else, would have allowed their women to travel out alone into the middle of Anatolia, 4 days by donkey from the nearest town to little villages, to inspect? And his answer, as you won't be surprised to hear, was silence. Anyway, moving on to 1911. So we've had internal disturbances, now we come to war. Nothing but wars from now on. 1911, of course, Italy occupies what's now Libya, which was of course then Ottoman territory, and they also took over the island of Rhodes. And the Italian fleet blockaded the Dardanelles, and Constantinople was cut off from Europe. And as a result of that, the banks, fearing the worst, closed their doors, cut off credit, no money, carpet orders cancelled, and of course these wretched weavers out in the middle of Anatolia never heard of Italy, never heard of Rhodes, and of course no orders, they're out of work. And it's just a tiny little footnote to this story, that after the Italian business was settled, the Treaty of Lausanne, one of the chief negotiators on the Italian side was Oscar Messir, who of course is a very close relation of the D'Andria family of Izmir, and of course there were Messiris in Izmir at the same time. So, you know, there's the Levantine connections all over the place. And then of course, then we come to the Balkan Wars, and of course that even had even more effect on business. 1912, 1913, war in the Balkans. Turkey loses Salonika. Bulgaria occupies Edirne. Constantinople is filled with Muslim refugees from the Balkans and from northern Greece. And the big problem, of course, was they brought with them diseases. They brought typhus, they brought cholera, which began to spread in the city. People were afraid to leave their houses. The city shuts down. And these are Muslims arriving. These are at Eminönü. And of course, the rich ones are the ones with the wagons. The shopping streets are deserted. Beyoğlu, hardly anybody around. Tourists stop coming. OCM had a big carpet shop here. They sold to tourists, no tourists. 100,000 refugees moved on. They moved on from Constantinople. They come down to Smyrna, bringing more disease with them. And the markets in Europe, they're nervous at the outcome of all these wars in the East. And of course, as commercial confidence goes down, the commerce slows down. But luckily, the American market holds up. And Fritz, of course, he'd got his branch in New York, and business, they keep managing to do business in New York. So now we move on to 1914. More wars, First World War. And of course, the picture that most of us have in this country of war is slaughter, mud and trenches in France and in Belgium, Flanders. But of course, for the Levantines in Turkey, things went rather differently. October 1914, the Ottoman government abolishes the capitulations unilaterally. So the OCM had been a London company, so it has to take on Turkish nationality, it has to become a Turkish citizen. They now depend on the no British consul to look after them. They depend on the Turkish government to look after them. And of course, come November, Turkey and Britain are at war. So where does that leave the OCM? Are they Turks? Are they British? What are they? Loyalty. And it's exactly the same situation as the English were in during the Falklands War. I mean, the English and the Argentina had been there for years and years and years, and suddenly they're at war with another country, but Argentina is home. But the point about all this is that the wool mills around Smyrna and Bandarmar, quite apart from producing wool for carpets, the wool that wasn't used for carpets was used for making cloth. And that cloth was used for making army uniforms, and for the army and for the gendarmerie. And the Ottoman government comes along and says, right, you've got to go on supplying us with the cloth we needed for our army. And so the company had to say to themselves, well, you know, should we? Are they Turks? We're British. Do we supply the enemy? What do we do? You know, who is the enemy? Are we Ottoman? Are we British? Anyway, to help them make up their minds, the government said, well, if you don't supply, we will confiscate your factories. So, and of course, the owners of the OCM, they'd been living in Turkey for hundreds of years, and the British anyway regarded them as foreigners. So they said, all right, we're Ottomans now, and so we'll carry on supplying. But at the back of their minds was the thought that the war would probably be quite short, and that at the end of the war, you know, they'd get their companies back. So they carry on, and they decided that anyway, you know, supplying arms is one thing, but supplying cloth wasn't going to make any difference, and if they didn't anyway, the government would take it. So they carried on. Now we come across the most extraordinary character. A wonderful man, and I would love someone to write his biography. This is the wonderful name, Evrenos Zadeh Rahmi Bey, who was the governor of Aydın. who came from an old landowning family of Salonika, and he was one of the Young Turks. And of course, at the outbreak of war over the rest of Turkey, all enemy nationals were imprisoned and exiled or sent off the country, and some of them were held in very tough and even hard conditions. But Ratmirbey was different. As soon as war was declared, he summoned the leaders of the European community in Izmir, and he said, right, you've got 12 days. You've got 12 days to make up your minds. And if you leave within 12 days, you can do so, I won't stop you. But if you decide to stay, I will protect you, and you can carry on in your houses, you can carry on in your businesses. And so a few, because they had family elsewhere or they wanted to go and join up and fight in Europe, left, but a great number stayed, including quite a lot of the old OCM families. Some of the young men went off and they fought in Europe. But not only did he look after the OCM factories, he also made sure that when they supplied their cloth to the Ottoman government, they actually got paid. And there are one or two letters I found in which he treated them as if they were guests. He said, you can keep your personal weapons, your personal sporting guns. If you want to go shooting duck, don't shoot duck. I won't stop you. And he gave them gendarmes to go with them to make sure nobody troubled them. And, you know, you think, well, why did he do this? And he was a very, very civilized man. And you think, well, perhaps he was thinking, you know, we don't quite know what the result of the war is going to be. It might be a good idea to, you know, keep a foot in both camps. And occasionally, because of his kindness to the Europeans, he got into trouble with Enver Pasha, who said, hey, you're getting a bit too friendly with the English. So when that happened, he got hold of half a dozen of them and he locked them up for a week. Very nice, you know, he looked after them, sent them food, very kind, but just locked them up. And of course, they got a report that he'd locked them up, so everybody was happy. And he treated them with the greatest of courtesy. And the sad thing was, at the very end of the war, the Allies imprisoned him, and they sent him off to Malta, because he was Ittihad-i Terakki, you know, he was the Young Turk War Party. And it took a great deal of effort from the OCM partners, and a hell of an effort, they actually got him out, finally. And when they did get him out, they had to wait for the peace treaty to be signed. And then after that, he was actually made a director of the OCM. So now, the war has finished. What are we left with? Huge amounts of carpets in stock. Why? No ships, no transport. They hadn't been able to export them. And this is great, because suddenly there's shipping, the economy in Europe gets going again, we've got large stocks of carpets, and there is a nice boom, at least in the Allied, in the victorious countries. Of course, the German economy is destroyed, Austro-Hungary is destroyed, the Vienna market is destroyed, but Western Europe is booming, and the OCM can take advantage of it. But once those stocks had been finished, they had a big problem, because they couldn't meet up with production. Why? As you've heard before, well, of course, they had lost a lot of their weavers. The Armenian weavers, of course, have gone after 1915. We now move on to 1919. And of course, as we all know, May 1919, the Greeks arrive in Smyrna and advance into Anatolia. A lot of destruction along the way, and particularly Gerdes, you know, the principal carpet weaving town, gets attacked and destroyed in 1921. Anatolian carpet production comes to a halt. Then we come to 1922, of course, as we all know, Mustafa Kemal, and September 1922, he enters, I love this photograph. If you look at it, you see that they're obviously going at a flat gallop along the front, along the corridor. It's been great fun doing that. And of course, four days later, we have the fire, and I'm sure you've all seen these photographs, but it's just worth reminding you, because it affected the company. Fire burned from the 13th to the 16th of September, and of course much of Smyrna gets destroyed, and some 2,000 lives were lost. And of course there's still an argument today as to who started it, and the Turks say it was the Greeks say it was the Turks, and everyone says it must have been the Armenians. Who knows? And of course, terrible scenes in the harbour, dreadful stories, the Allied naval vessels, French, British, Italian naval vessels lying at anchor. And they're all under orders only to rescue people from their own nationals. The Italians were the only people who took off people who were not their own nationals, has to be said. And the Greeks now mean plunging into the sea, and some survived, and of course a lot didn't. But as far as the OCM is concerned, their head office, of course, as you saw, was right on the quay there. The house is burned, their stock is destroyed, and alongside them were the American Tobacco Company, and they lost their entire stock of tobacco. And unfortunately for the companies, the court found in favour of the insurance companies. In other words, they decided that it was, in fact, an act of war and not an accident. So as far as the OCM was concerned, that wiped £100,000 sterling off their books. And we're talking, that's sort of $8 million roughly today. But the court decision later enabled them to enter claims for damages against the Turkish government after the war by way of war reparations. And I haven't been able to discover what happened. I don't think anything came of that. But anyway, these are, in the big scale of things, they're small matters compared to what followed, because, of course, after the Great War, we get the Turkish Republic. And just to move on in picture terms, I found in a private collection this photograph that I expect very few of you have seen. This is Mustafa Kemal with Latife and Kazım Karabekir on manoeuvres outside Smyrna in 1923 or thereabouts, as far as I remember. Anyway, so 1923, of course, we get the exchange of populations, and I don't need to tell you about that, but what effect did it have on the carpet company? Well, I can tell you straight away. The Armenians had gone in 1915, and in 1923, of course, their Greek weavers also leave. They have to go to Greece. And the ones they could get together, they set up outside Athens. They built a little factory there. They got them working in Athens. And they also put some of them on the island of Rhodes. And of course, the advantage of Rhodes was that it was still under Italian occupation, and as such, they could export carpets produced in Rhodes into Italy without paying any customs duties. So that did quite well. But Athens never really worked. Wages were high because it's in a big city. So back in Turkey, what's happening? The new republic, they impose taxes on trade, make trade quite difficult. Then, of course, the 1920s, Bolshevik Russia is a threat, and the traders of Persian and Caucasian carpets in Constantinople leave. They go to London, because, of course, what people often forget, that until this period, the centre for the Persian carpet trade was actually Istanbul. Persian carpets came from Tabriz or Baghdad, and they came through to Istanbul, and from there they went to Europe. With all these export taxes, all these problems, the trade became very difficult. Soviet Russia was breathing down their necks, so that all the traders, the upsticks, and they come to London. And London, what do? We get, hang on, I'm trying to, somewhere. Doesn't matter. They set up bonded warehouses in the docks. And that's where they end up. So the carpet business is now based in London. Istanbul is now history as far as carpet trade concerns. Until this period, Istanbul had been a world centre of the whole Oriental carpet trade. And this shift is a perfect illustration of the effect of politics on commerce. And of course, the European governments were just as bad. And they imposed protective trade tariffs by way of imperial preference. So Indian carpets come into England duty-free. Algerian carpets come into France almost duty-free. The Turkish trade, therefore, can't compete against this. It's all obstructed. So the once thriving Turkish carpet industry, which had employed tens and tens of thousands, and not just weavers, but carders, spinners, dyers, all sorts of ancillary workers, destroyed by war and politics, taxes, and political instability. And as if that's not enough, we come up to 1928. At that point, the Turkish government realizes that they made a mistake with their restrictive tax regime, and they relax their taxes, and commerce suddenly flourishes again. And there was a very, very brief boom, just for less than a year. Suddenly exports get going again. Until 1929, what happens? The Wall Street crash. The only Turkish carpets exporter was the wonderful Çolak Zade. He had kept going almost alone amongst all the others. And he was a clever man. He saw this crash coming, and he had big stocks of carpets in New York. He managed to sell a lot before the big crash. Well, of course, their value, everybody else's values of stocks just dropped nothing. He did well. But again, once they'd gone, business all over Europe, the States, comes to a halt. And once again, these poor, illiterate weavers in the villages of Turkey and in Persia now find themselves out of work as a consequence of follies committed by supposedly educated people of whom they had never heard. So this is a patchwork of a story. I've rattled through it very fast, but I've told it really so that you could look at the history of this company and the times that it lived in and think about some questions about nationality, some questions about sovereignty, the necessity for maintaining conditions favourable for trade and industry, and the need at the same time for control of banks and of commercial institutions, and the need for economic and political stability without sclerosis. Because today we're all faced with the same questions, but we're not the first to have faced them. Many of today's problems faced us 100 years ago. And if we can reflect on the mistakes that were made then, perhaps we can come up with some better solutions now. Thank you very much.
If there are any questions, please raise your hands and maybe I can start the first question. Get things going. Clearly, the OCN had a very organized system of dyeing patterns and designs. But did they follow traditional designs, or did they start introducing, shall we say, dumbing down the authentic old carpet designs?
Well, it's a bit of both. I mean, a lot of people, those are the purists in the carpet trade, carpet collectors, shall we say, they sort of curse the OCM for, as you say, dumbing down carpet design. But then you have to think about, and we're talking about business, sadly. As you saw from the catalogue, I mean, the early production, the Spartali production, they produced very, very fine pieces. And they carried on doing this for as long as they could. But then it's all a question of price. I mean, those carpets were expensive. And if you look at the history of carpets, until the people like the OCM came along, Oriental carpets were very expensive, they were finely produced, and they were made for rich people only, in Turkey, in Persia, and a few for export. And then suddenly you get this demand in Europe for, you know, the middle classes, even the lower middle classes. They couldn't afford this sort of thing at all. So they had to produce something cheaper. Well, you can't produce very fine carpets cheaply. Then the next question comes up. You're starting up, you're getting new weavers going, you're getting these village girls. A lot of them had to learn weaving from nothing. You had to teach them. And you could only teach them to do simple designs. But in effect, what you've got is it's a mass production for a mass market, which was there. And you've got, I mean, at the time, I mean, if you, before, up until the war, even, yes, I mean, up until the Second World War, you go to almost any English house of, you know, lower middle classes even, and every single house had one of these red carpets, and the knots in it were as big as your fingernail, but they had them. And is it, call it, if they said, well, we must only produce very good carpets, well, there wouldn't have been no production. It's two different markets altogether, but of course, now what's happened is that middle market has completely dried up. Today's young people don't want to spend that sort of money anyway. So the middle production, middle of the road production has collapsed. And it's, I think it's rather good in a way, because you're going back to the old days where you've just got very fine production. Henrique, you know, there's a production is going now. People are going back to producing fine silk carpets, natural dyes, for people who could afford them. So that was just, it was a blip, if you like. And now the sort of IKEA carpets produced in Vietnam have taken over.
Anthony, you had a photograph there of a Pamuk cottager who was fluffing up the wool.
Yes.
And you used an English word for the process, I think.
Carder.
Carding. Carding, okay.
Yes. Cottager, carder. Yes.
But and the tool that he was using, is there a particular name for it?
A bow, you'd call it. A bow, yes.
Yeah. I still remember the noise of that.
Yeah?
It had a wonderful pinging.
Yes, when I was in Hamadan.
They had a rhythm to it.
Yeah. No, but I mean, when I lived in Hamadan, I mean, there was nothing there. It was very, very traditional when I arrived there. And we had a toshak, a cotton mattress. Yeah. And of course, you buy it and it's all like that, and after a bit, it goes down to nothing. And then you summon the guy, he comes along with his bow, and he opens your up, and he sits in your house, you plink, 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 you know, for half a day, and then it's all fluffed up again.
And there was another photograph of the Ketchajis.
Yeah.
Making felt.
Yes.
That's
what we have. They were great days.
Excuse me, when did the company actually officially close down? I mean, how did it end?
Well, what happened then, you see, when after 1929 and so on, then the Turkish carpet business more or less dried up. So the company is now a London company, and they are now, of course, they didn't really bore you with the retail. In 1911, they set themselves up in Iran, and the same sort of system, but they took over, I think, about half the Persian carpet production. So then the business, then they had Persian carpets, they had Caucasians, they were bringing him in from the Caucasus. And in India, of course, they set up factories right along the Ganges. And they kept going until, and then eventually they got taken. Then, of course, sadly, the money boys took over. And the family firms, you get sort of, there are men who want money, and then you have the carpet people who want to produce. And the money people realize this is the wonderful cash cow. And they had these properties smack in the middle of the city of London, and they decided to sell out for the value of the commercial property in London was more than the carpet business is worth. Other people took it over, and they didn't understand their business properly. And then it all sort of collapsed, and very sadly, the carpet now doesn't exist.
So what would it have been the last years of
1980, help.
Really?
Oh, five, six, there? Thereabouts. Yes. Yes. Finally, yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Did they specialise only in carpets, or did they do kilims? Did they as well?
They didn't produce kilims, no.
Right.
And then they, much later on, actually, right in the, we're talking now sort of, 80s, late 70s, 80s, they began, kilims became quite fashionable over here, and then they started bringing them in. But they just bought them from people that were producing them. They didn't sort of commission them particularly, and they brought them in from Turkey and also from Iran.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I know you mentioned we might learn some lessons, looking at our current commercial global, etc., etc. Do you, in the book, which I intend to buy, I'll find out, do you comment on the interplay?
Well, yes, I mean, it's quite interesting because when I was doing research, my research in Izmir, there was a delightful, I'd been to Izmir briefly, but in the days before I started thinking about this, and I got a lot of help from the university there. And I was astonished to find that the people in the university, they knew straight away all about the OCM there. It was a huge part of Izmir life, had been. And the people in the Ottoman history department, they're not the Ottoman, but the late Ottoman, early Republic history, they knew all about it, and they were very, very welcoming. And they pointed me in all sorts of directions and produced all kinds of archives for me. And I was in the office of one of the very nice assistant professors, and after lunch, and we were chatting away. And he looked at me watching, saying, "Oh," he said, "Antony, I've got my students coming now. Would you mind giving them a talk?" So I said, "Oh, help! What about?" "Oh, he said, just talk." I prepared nothing. Anyway, there were 12, 15 students came in, and I had to deliver the talk in Turkish, which limited me a bit. And I thought, well, I'll just give the line history of the company. In 1906, this, 7, 8, something else. And I started describing the history of how the company started. And then I got up to 1908, and the Young Turks. And I was a bit lost as well to say about the Young Turks. So I asked for help, and I said, no, Professor, you're the historian. Perhaps you'd like to tell the students what, you know, about the Young Turks. They says, he talked a bit about the Young Turks, and we got the story a little bit further. And I said, ah, of course, at that point, this happened, which meant that the company then had to change and do this, and so on, and that takes up the First World War. Perhaps you'd like to talk about why Turkey joined the First World War. And then he got a bit, and I said, ah, then Rahmi Bey comes in, he did this company, and we batted the thing back and forth. And it just totally spontaneously. And then the wonderful, the students suddenly said, oh, but hang on, what about this, and what about that? And what meant to be 40 minutes went on for an hour and a half. It was absolute magic. And it was great, because then they invited me back, very kindly, to go back to give another lecture, this time to the art department, the fine arts department, the lovely lady there. She had a collection of all the designs. She knew all about them. I'd never met her on the first trip. So she had all the old designs. And this time we got about 70 or 80 students. And then we did a three-hander, you see. She did the designs, and we had the carpet, the company, the commercial bit, the political bit, the carpet design bit, the production bit. And again, this thing, you know, it came to life. And we just suddenly realized, you know, the sort of, people study history, they study commerce, they study art. And we suddenly found a way of, you know, putting it all together and see the effect of one having on the other.
And it's all in your book, is it?
As far as I can get it, yes. That was the whole point. I really wanted to talk about, I mean, there are millions of books about carpets, so that buying in, 100, but nobody, as far as I know, has done a sort of a social history of what he was like out in the village, what he was like, you know, to be, you're the representative of OCM in some village right up in Sivas somewhere. You've got to go plodding along on a donkey to these villages, and there are these wretched people, they're stealing your wool, and you know, they've got to pay them, and then they get the designs wrong, and you've got to shake them up. And then somebody else has come barging into the village and saying to the girls, all right, you know, these people are paying you so much a square foot, I'll pay you more. So your weavers said, no, we're going to weave for you, they're halfway through your carpet, and they sell the carpet to somebody else. All these things happen, and nobody's written about that as far as I know. So you know, the idea is to say, you know, all these carpets dotted over people's house, how the hell, how did they get here? What have they been through to get here? That's what it's about.
And the book reads beautifully. It's like a novel. You will not want to put it down. It's not a novel.
Well, it's very good. But it talks also, I mean, I've only talked about the Turkish bit, but I do the same thing for what happened in Persia, the same thing for what happened in India and Afghanistan. All of them for the same company.
But it's hugely relevant to development in Africa and isn't it? Well, it'll either work. But
the message is that, you know, if you get the right political situation, people thrive, businesses thrive. But if you muck it up, things don't work.
And what's happening now? Carpets are being produced in Turkey.
Oh,
Iran.
It's desperate, absolutely desperate. There are, you know, these big warehouses up in Wembley. I mean, I've got a friend. He's a lorry. He runs a transport business. Lorries up between Tehran and London. He's English with an Iranian wife. And he says, you won't believe it, I am now taking carpets back to Iran. Can't sell them here. There's no market here because people don't want to spend money. They get a decent carpet. You've got to spend at least £700, at least for something small of any decent thing. And people are much, and you know, it'll last you a lifetime, but people now, they'd rather spend £200 on something like IKEA and throw it out 2 years later. Mm. But there it is.
We had the same problem with our carpet dealership in South Africa, where people just couldn't, mainly to doctors, lawyers, and...
And of course, it's all labour costs now, and labour has become very expensive. Mm. So now, I mean, it's gone crazy. You've got Oriental carpets, Persian designs and so on, being made in, they went to India to begin with, Pakistan, getting expensive, so then they go to China, that's getting expensive, now they're doing it in Vietnam.
Yeah.
And Persian carpets being woven in Vietnam. Yes, they are very fine, but you look at them, and they've got that sort of rather dead, sort of machine-made look, that's sort of too perfect. Mm.
Yeah. Our best sumacs we used to get from China.
Yeah. It's a great shame, but... You know, as I said, there is this tiny little sort of revival of the, what I call the real luxury carpet. There are still some enthusiasts, and thank goodness there's some money in Turkey. People are prepared to, you know, pay good money for good carpets. And that, I think, perhaps is as it should be. And of course in Iran, which I know far more about because I lived and worked in Iran for 4 years. In the villages, they are now not weaving rugs, sort of cheap rugs for export, which they can't sell. They've got a bit of money, but in the long winters, you know, you've got snow up to there, and you're sitting in the little mud house with the table in front of you, and the charcoal underneath, and the quilt thing over your the doshek, you know, over your the haf, what do you call it? Yorgan over the top of up to up to your chin, you know, keeping warm. And they get a bit bored, so they start. Come on, let's make a rug, but we'll make a good one. And so they make good ones for themselves. Mm. And one day, they might come onto the market.
Now they are making out of silk as well as the wool.
Yeah.
Silk carpets.
Yeah, very fine ones. Mm. Yes. Yeah. Anyway.
For the walls.
So, I don't know why, but I shouldn't be a pessimist. At least they got rid of the rubbish, so the people who are complaining about the dumbing down can say, well, it's gone, the cycle, the wheel has come full circle.
It was a very interesting talk.
Thank you.
Carpet is always my interest. Mm. The only thing I was a bit disappointed, you know, having foreigners in Turkish carpet making. I never thought about that. You know, in small villages when we visited, we saw people still doing, and every region they've got their own, you know, pattern.
Yeah.
And also color changes accordingly.
Yeah.
So I thought, you know, it is our own design. I never thought Armenian, you know, or Greek,
but
we involved in.
Ottomans.
But in between, I think, I'm sure, some, you know.
Of course they were, yes. Oh, yes, no, I'm sorry, I don't misunderstand me. I mean, before all this got going, yes, of course, I mean, they were,
yeah,
what you like to call, they were
yes.
Turkish, for want of a better word. I mean, Turkish wasn't the word they used in those days.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they were not Rum. You know, they had their own designs, and they
yes.
these beautiful, beautiful things. And then these other more sort of simple designs came up later.
I see.
I was going to say, I mean, just as a point of interest, to give you the scale of the thing, these very nice people in Izmir University, they took me after this lecture. We went up into the hills behind, and we found a place where they were dyeing, and all silk, natural dyes with silk.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw them producing the silk out of the, you know, the cocoons, and
mm-hmm.
threading it all, dyeing it, and weaving the finest, finest things. We couldn't see the knots, they were so fine. And then they took us to Uşak, and we went to see some old houses. And we met a very old lady there, and she was weaving away. And she said, you know, up until the First World War, she said 600 camels a week were leaving Uşak, going down to Izmir, carrying carpets for export. I mean, it's colossal, the scale of it. And I said, what's happening now?
Nothing.
And she said, well, three carpets a month. Three single carpets a month, which is very sad, but there we are.
I think they are producing a lot in different types, in different, you know, cities.
Yeah.
And there is, you know, the fashion now, people don't like to cover the whole floor with carpet. They have got wood now.
Yeah.
So when you have wood on the wood,
yes,
I think it's very nice to put a piece of carpet
yes.
on it. So it's still, I think, getting more, but I think production is more, or people are doing more.
Yes.
Maybe that's why I hope.
Mm. Mm. No, I hope people will realize the value of these things, because, you know, a good carpet lasts for generations.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Make a brilliant wedding present.
Well, that's what they wear, of course.
Yeah,
that's exactly what they wear. I mean, in the villages, in these villages, I knew jolly well that you know, a girl, when she was sort of, well, she started at the age of 9, and mum sat on that, come on now, we're going to, this is your dowry. You know, start, get busy, and when it's finished, we marry you off. You take it with you.
The young officer, Uşakızade officer, was he a relative of Latife's
father.
Ah.
Mm.
Yes,
Latifanum was a Uşakızade
really?
Girl as well.
That I didn't know. I've got her biography. I haven't confess, read it yet. I don't know.
Right, any more questions?
I'd like to thank again Antony Wynn for a very interesting lecture. So, thank you very much.
Yes.